close, let's get intimate. All right, we're kind of far away from each other. Let's demonstrate that we love each other.
Man, can you stand with me for our call to worship this afternoon? Come to the 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Regarded Christ in this way.
We do so no longer. Therefore, if anybody is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. This is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God himself is reconciling the world to himself, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the ministry and the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us.
Right.
We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Amen. At this time, Pastor Pierce is going to come and pray for the service.
Amen. Let's pray, church. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name. Praise him tonight, church. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, that you are the greatest soul winner. God, at the beginning of time, hallelujah. God, you started looking for mankind. Lord Jesus, when we wandered away, when we were so far, you started looking for us, God. You never lost track of us when we lost track of you. I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you sent your son to bring us back into relationship with you. And God, that is the cry of your heart, to bring us back into relationship with you. Father, tonight, if there's any individual, Lord Jesus, who has gotten off track, Father, I pray that you would bring them back home tonight, home to your heart, Father. Lord Jesus, I pray that tonight, that our hearts would be stirred, Lord Jesus, to take the ministry, the call that you have for each one here, Lord Jesus, that ministry of reconciliation, that ministry of bringing people back into a relationship with you, Lord Jesus. God, that you would stir our hearts, Lord Jesus, to want to know you more and to want to bring others to know you more. Father, that you would just help us to lift up your name and glorify you tonight in our worship and in our praise. Father, I thank you that you have a purpose for each one here, that your greater purpose, Father, is to bring us back to you. And Father, let us rejoice in that relationship that we have with you tonight. Father, let us lift up your name. Let us glorify you tonight, Lord Jesus, and let us rejoice. Rejoice, Lord Jesus, for the work that you have done in us and the work that you're going to do this week. Father, bring Allentown back. God, that you would let it start here, that you would let it start tonight, start in our hearts and in our lives, Father. Bring Allentown and the Lehigh Valley back into a relationship with you. And Father, that it would start in the hearts of these ones here tonight. Father, we lift up your name. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Listen, if I could encourage you to move up over here a little bit. Small service starting out now. This is just the fuse. This is the match that lights the fuse. Thank you, Lord.
I'm gonna tell some.
to be people who trust you, God, even with our money, Father. Father, we ask, oh God, that you will take this offering, oh Lord, and that you will bless it, oh Lord. Let it meet all the needs that we have, Father. Help us, oh Lord, to give us an increase, oh God, so that we may be able to take care of the needs of the community. In your precious name we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Definite
time. I know we're going to be taking out some chunks of time. I just want you to stop and see me at the service. I'm going to shorten our service today. I'm not going to preach long. We just want to start to set the pace. I think this morning, 4 people, 2 adults, 2 children getting saved is pretty cool, right? You know what I mean? And so we're going to start a follow-up team. I'm going to have Pastor Lewis take these and push each one back one so that we have enough room to put more than multiple teams in there. Tomorrow we'll get the ball rolling. We're going to finish our fence in the back. The kitchen is being done now. All the food is being taken down there. You know, all that's getting ready. And so I just want to encourage you to just come on out. You know, revival services, right? Everybody has heard of them, right? Revival services, right? I had somebody tell me today, are you having revival services next week, right? I thought, well... That's that revival service next week. We're having a revival next week. We're bringing the dead to life next week. To revive is to bring something, you know, back to life. So next week, we're doing that next week. So next week will be the week, Greg. It's the only week we got. We got 1 week to have revival. I thought, man, you ain't been attending church too long, have you? I said, we've been in a revival process for a long time. Matter of fact, as far as I can tell, it hasn't been 7 years. Right? Has it been 7 years? It's been years. Those of you that have been around, it's been years. You know what they say? They say this is the 7th year, the year of Jubilee, the year of freedom. It's the year. And you think, well, you know, I mean, where did you get that from? You know, well, anybody here ever filed bankruptcy? Don't raise your hand. But you know why there's 7 years? It's biblical, because at the end of 7 years, you know what they're saying about America's lands, their farming, all the farming is going bad. Did you know that? Amen. Watch the news, guys. There's more stuff than just HBO, you know. They say that farmers right now are suffering, and you know why they're suffering?
Forward and never change again. And folks, what's going to make a revival, I mean a real revival, what we don't need is a revival that lasts 1 week. That's something I'm already planning for the end of this week. There's going to be a follow-up team. There's already in place. There's already a follow-up team because I want to go get people this time. As soon as they get saved, within 48 hours, I want somebody at their house, at their front door. Because we need a revival that lasts more than 7 days. We need an awakening that lasts more than 7 days. And so, folks, I want you to put your shoulder to the plow and start carving some ground here in Allentown. And don't let go. And don't look back. I'm not saying you always got to be pushing, always got to be forcing. You know, I'm just saying let's set the pace. Let's go forward and let's not let go this year. This is our year of freedom. This is our year of jubilee. And if we want it, all we got to do is do our part and work for it, and the Lord will do his part. Amen? Yeah. And let me share with you. In the book of 1 Kings chapter 18, I preached from this a week or two ago, but I wanted to show you something here. 1 Kings chapter 18 verse 21. And my first point is this: we don't want a revival that lasts a week. We don't want a revival that's only a week long. Amen? Amen. Come on, say amen if you're in agreement with that. Prior to it, then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord, the God who answers by fire. He will be God. Now he's got these 450 prophets, and he's got the people of Israel. And so what he's saying to the people of Israel, he's saying, guys, how long are you going to vacillate between two gods? How long are you going to mess around between the world or serving God? How long are you going to do this? He said, but look, I'll show you what I do. Give me a bull, and this one is yours. If you got a God, okay, call on your God. And then here's mine. And I'll call on my God. And whoever comes down in fire and consumes that sacrifice, he will be the God. Everybody in agreement? And they said yes. They waited around. Let me tell you what happens next. Then all the people said, what you say is good. And Elijah said to the prophets about choose a bull first. Then they called on the name of the Lord. I'm going down to verse 26. So they took the bull given to them and prepared it. Then they called on the name of the Lord. And then they called on the name of Baal from morning till noon. Oh, Baal, answer us, they shouted. But there was no response. No one answered. And they danced around the altar that they had made. At noon, Elijah began to taunt them. Shout louder, he said. He was starting to goof on them. Surely he is a god. Perhaps he is in deep thought or busy or traveling. Maybe he is sleeping and must be awakened. So they shouted louder.
paid attention. Then Elijah said to the people, come here to me. They came to him, and he prepared, and he repaired the altar of the Lord, which was in ruins. Elijah took 12 stones, one for each of the tribes of the descendant from Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, your name shall be Israel. With the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he began to, and he dug a trench around it, large enough to hold two seas of seed. He arranged the wood, cut the bull into pieces, and laid it on the wood. Then he said to them, fill four as large jars with water and pour it on the offering and on the wood. Do it again, he said, and they did it again. Do it a third time, he ordered, and they did it a third time. The water ran around the altar and even filled the trench. Can you imagine? I mean, he lets all the prophets of Baal call on their God all day long. He said, maybe he's out to lunch. Maybe he's at potty time or something. I don't know where your God is. But listen, take mine now. Put stones in here instead of everything else. Put my sacrifice and fill it with water. Well, not once, not twice, but three times. At the time of the sacrifice, in verse 36, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and prayed, O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord. Answer me, so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice. Say amen.
Amen.
The wood, the stones, and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. When all the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, the Lord, he is God, the Lord, he is God. Then Elijah commanded them, seize the prophets of Baal. Don't let anyone... the Shan Valley, and there he slaughtered them. You might think that's a deep, deep day, isn't it? I mean, that's a powerful day, isn't it? And yet, let me tell you how long that revival lasted, right? Maybe a day, maybe 2 or 3 days, maybe 4 days later, they were still talking about how Elijah called down fire. Maybe 5 days later, they were still talking about how Elijah called down fire. Maybe 6 days later, they were still feeling and reminiscing the fact that fire had come down on the stones and that even the water was dissipated and melted away. But I can tell you one thing. Just a little while later, a few verses later, it says Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah. Say, you prophet who called down, you prophet who killed my 450 prophets. It said, you, may it be by tomorrow if I don't kill you. If I don't kill you by tomorrow. And what did he do? He started running. You see what I'm saying in church? I'm saying anybody can specialize in a revival that lasts a week. Anybody can pump it up and hype it up and bring in a big speaker and do something that lasts a week. But we don't need a revival that lasts 1 week. We don't need a revival that lasts a little bit of time. We need the people of God to be reawakened and reawakened completely. We don't want to see a small manifestation of God. We don't want to see 150 people. Oh my God, Tuesday night, 170 people. Oh my Lord, Wednesday night, 250 people. Man, we're on the move. Look at us, man. We're on fire. through the power, and I don't want to look back again. I'm tired. And sometimes I listen to me. I know I'm preaching to the choir here tonight. I know I'm preaching to the faithful, but maybe it's the faithful in this room. Maybe it's the faithful. Maybe it's you that need to become the leaders. Maybe it's you that need to become those power pushers. Maybe it's you that the rest of the church is watching. Maybe it's you that the rest of the church is saying, I want to see what you do when the chips are down. I want to see what you do when there's no money out. I want to see what you do when you can't pay your bills. I want to see what you do when somebody dies. Had a good friend die today on the way to the Poconos. We're driving, it took a turn, hit a pole, she's dead. I don't have many friends from my past. Friday night, my uncle died. My mother was crying. She said, I'm getting old. All my family's dying. I don't know what to do, Jimmy. I don't know what to do. He called me a little while ago, said my sister is depressed. She doesn't want to live anymore. And I thought, I started praying. I said I could jump in my little car and go down and take $100 here, take $50 there, and go hug them there. And then I said, just stop praying, man. Because I know what the devil's trying to do to me. I know what he's trying to do. I put my shoulder to the plow. I want you to know I'm not preaching this from the vantage point of somebody that does not know. Had my mom call me Friday. Mom called me back today. Another person died. I thought, what is going on? What's up with this? Folks, I've had a revival that lasts more than a week. Amen. I'm not having no revival for the end of June. Mr. Bruce and Pastor Jim, I hope we're having early morning services now. And this is how they looked asking me. I said, oh my God, you would think you were preaching. You would think I asked you to preach. Early morning services. That's just in case you need to go visit family, you can come to a 1-hour service and go. I'm just trying to accommodate you. It's not me. It's not that I need to wear myself out anymore. Lord knows I don't need to play anything else. Find me somebody who can play that. I'd love to give them to them. Oh, I know I play well. I know that. I've been playing 30 years. I should be able to play well for 30 years. Find me somebody that can play them. I would love to give them to them. I'd love to sit down and read my Bible while they're worshiping. I would love to do that. Give me some leaders, man. Give me some people that put their shoulder to the plow. Say, I want to learn something. Timothy grabbed sticks 5 years ago. Now he's a master drummer. Right around. Find your kids. Give them an instrument, man. Do something with them. 2 or 3 years from now, they'll be on the money. Make an investment in them. Try it. Buy them an instrument, man. Do something with them. Come on. I'm sorry. I'm preaching some other stuff now. Anyway, are you with me? So what we don't need is a revival that lasts a week, man. That's not what we want. That's not what I'm looking for. Oh, Greg Hubbard is coming with the, anointed preacher. Well, he won't be here next Wednesday. Yeah. It'll just be us again. Yeah. What? Yeah. Really want to be anointed guy. Yeah. You stuck with me? Think about it. What are you going to do next Wednesday? Not this Wednesday. Salvos is going to be here. Latin music. Ooh, man. Buffet downstairs. Free meal. What are you going to do next Wednesday after that? Are we still going to be on fire? Because if you are, let me tell you something you got to do. You got to do something I've been doing for months and months and months and even years. You better start lighting that fuse now. You better start lighting that fuse now. And if you you're burning out, then I tell you stop running in the flesh. If you're burning out, stop doing the flesh dance. Oh, I'm just tired. Well, I guess I wonder why you're tired. I run around here all day long and still have energy enough to chase my wife at night. Praise God. Thank you for that applause. I mean, that does, I mean, loving one's wife, does that deserve an applause? You get caught up in your flesh and you ain't got time to love people around you. Life will be all about you. Why do I keep saying that? Somebody need to hear that, say amen. We get caught up, don't we? We need a revival. Number one, that's not just a week long. Are you with me? Say amen. Amen. Please don't let this just last 7 days. Come on, are we going to do this thing here? Man, I mean, 7 days, I mean, if that's it, what a waste. What a waste. I don't mind a small crowd on Sunday night. I think that's kind of intimate. We bring this thing down and we share with those that are truly, truly there. You know, they want a little bit more. That's fine with us. I mean, we'll shorten this service and stuff like that, make it a little bit more comfortable in the summertime that you get home early. But please don't let your lifestyle be a lifestyle that is revived for a week in the year. If the enemy works 365 days a year, then can't we serve God 365 days a year? Does the devil's people take a break?
No.
Monday through Saturday? I mean, it'd be nice. I mean, if the devil said, okay, Satana, okay, everybody, demons, okay, go raise hell, okay, it's 9 o'clock, go home, oh God, can that, man, I mean, that'd be life, wouldn't it?
Right. Yes.
I mean, I go to work and everything is beautiful, and life is good, and good, everything. Okay, it's Sunday, get ready. Okay, the demons are coming, okay, here, and yelling door, Sunday morning, you know? I mean, it'd be fun if we just had battle with the devil one day a week. But it's not that way. He's on the job 24/7, 365 days a year until Jesus comes. We got to serve God every day of our life. Maybe that means some of you got to change your lifestyle. Maybe you just ain't living right. Oh, you're religious. You even a Christian. You even born again. Maybe you just ain't living right. Maybe there's some stuff you need to get rid of so you can walk circumspectly, you know, in the center of Christ. Amen? Number two, we need a revival. We don't need a revival that's only hearing and not doing. Come on now, say amen. We don't need a revival that's a week longer. And secondly, we don't need a revival that's only hearing but not doing. Oh, people love. Oh, Greg Hubbard is coming. Greg Hubbard will be in the house on Wednesday. Shiloh will be in the house on Friday night. Corey Redd and Precise will be in the house on Friday night and Saturday. Outdoor water baptism with free all-beef hot dog Saturday. Woo, man, I like the sound of that. Don't you? I do. But folks, if you want to have a revival, a reawakening of the people of God, we need to ask God for a revival that is more than just hearing. A revival that is doing. Everybody likes to have their ears tickled. But it's not just about having it good, man. The music was good. What's in that slamming? Sango's ain't gonna be here next week after that. Oh, well, I ain't coming. There was a man in I hope I don't get this wrong. Well, I won't give it a date, so I won't mess it up, but it was in the early 19th century when some churches didn't have electric, right? And so he bequeathed this little country church. He left them a giant building. He left them enough money and had it scheduled and contracted to build them a beautiful church. I mean, kind of cool, right? He dies, he leaves all his insurance money to build them a beautiful big church, right? In the church, he put no lighting, no candles. In the back, he had candles. Now, back in those times, they'd get a little gas in right here, they'd put candles in, like or something like that, but he put none in. What he did was that he made this rack. He had them build a rack that had all these little candles, and they put them at the entrance of the church. He said, show you about people that hear but didn't want to do, okay? My second point. Ezekiel chapter 33. Say amen when you're there. If you're just going to listen to me, just say amen. Okay? Ezekiel chapter 33. It says, Ezekiel then spoke to the exiles in Babylon. These are the children of God, okay, that had now been taken into captivity, all right, Susan, they're in captivity now. It says, so Ezekiel spoke to the exiles in Babylon. He had developed a popular following among the people who recognized him as a prophet. They frequently gathered to hear his messages. The people liked to hear God's word, but neglected to obey it. Amen. You with me? It said they liked to hear Ezekiel speak, but they didn't like to do what he said. It said all Ezekiel had to do was say, hey, listen, I'm going to be here, and there'd be a cloud. Sound familiar? The man would say he'd be there, and there was a cloud. They said yesterday morning, they called people up and said, Pastor Jim is going to be speaking tonight. And the place, the Second Baptist, it was full. There was a cloud. They said, wow, good turnout tonight. I was thinking of patting myself on the back, and then this point came to my mind. Is it about you, Jimmy? Because I don't need a revival that's about hearing but not doing. I don't need a revival that's about a man but not about walking along. I don't need a revival that's about hearing stuff that will titillate our ears and our spirit and our soul and make us feel good, but it's not about doing. James said, be ye doers of the word and not hearers only. And folks, we don't need a revival that's just about hearing good messages and good music this week from Shiloh Baptist and the Latin Praiser. We don't need that. We need doing this week. Amen. And we need doing next week. Whatever we hear this week, every message we get this week, soak it in and say, God, show me something. Revive my soul. Change my attitude. Change my mental disposition. Make me a new man, a new individual in Christ. Amen. And help me to change.
Amen.
I'm tired of hearing. You know what happens when you get used to just hearing good all the time? You get sick of it. What's your favorite dessert? Come on, just think of it. Think of your favorite dessert. Now have one cup of it. Good, right? Have another. Good. Have another. Good. Have another. Good. Have another. It's good. Have another. You get used to that. I need to hear the fire of the word. And can't nobody come in here and preach to you and say, you know what? Jesus is Lord. He is the all-sufficient center of your life. Jesus should be at the very center of your life. Everything that you do, he should be the centrifugal force in your family unit. Everything should revolve around him. You should be able to hear the gospel in the simplest form and still get excited.
Amen.
But we're not that kind of people now. We need to know. Give me the big name. Who's the fire? Woo! What's going to happen next? Now what's going to happen? Wow! We want a bigger worship team, a bigger choir. Now fire! Snake dancing! What do we do next? We're going to have a revival. We're going to have a revival here. It's about doing everything you've learned this year. It's about souls. It's about balance. It's about the Spirit. It's about power. It's about prayer. It's about the Word. It's about confession. It's about contrition. It's about repentance. It's about change. It's about humility. It's about being strong. It's about being courageous. It's about being consistent. It's about having continuity. It's about being a model. It's about nurturing. It's about nursing. It's about setting an example. It's about giving. It's about taking. It's about receiving. It's about sharing. It's about loving. It's about caring. You heard it all. You've heard it all this year. And now it's about doing. Now it's about doing. Now it's about doing this stuff. Now it's about putting teeth on it and doing it. Somebody say amen. I'm not mad at you. I'm just excited. I'm loaded for all next week. And I don't think I'll ever sleep. Just, she'll make me go to sleep. And I'll lay there. That's it, man. The bag I got next to my bed now, dried out. She told me, put this clothespin on it to keep them crisp for you. I think during our devotions. No, just joking. Revival, that's hearing but not doing. We don't need it. Revival, that's a week long. Come on, say, we don't need it.
Amen.
You know the third kind of revival that you don't need? A revival that's pleasing but not convicting.
Amen.
Come on, say, we don't need it.
Amen.
You can get that anywhere. You got all kind of churches having their revival services right now. Just go to one. They'll be pleasing. Oh, man, you should have. Oh, if you just, ooh, there go. Oh, man, there go. Oh, ooh. Man, you, oh, the walking. Oh, my, oh, the, ooh, yeah, what? I don't know, but it felt good. What was the sermon about? Oh, it's, like Jesus, you know, like, you don't know, do you? You don't know. A lot of people catch me and say, Pastor Dan, that was a great sermon. Really? What point did you like, I said? Oh, they were all good. The whole plethora of points was up. I enjoyed them all equally. Listen, you can make a lot of noise up here. Sometimes less is better. Less points is better. I'm learning that as I get older now. Sometimes less is better. You follow me? First kind of revival that we don't need is a revival that lasts. Second thing that we don't need is a revival that's hearing but not. Third kind of revival that we don't need is a revival that is pleasing but not convicting. The book of Amos chapter 5, let me just read it to you. Amos chapter 5 says this. Amos chapter 5, the prophet Amos says this to the people. He's speaking for God, by the way, in a prophetic sense, okay? He said, I hate, Amos chapter 5, verse 21, I hate, I despise your feasts, and I will take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Yea, though you offer me burnt offerings and meal offerings, I will not accept them, neither will I regard thy peace offerings of your fat beasts. Take thou away from me the noise of thy songs. For I will not hear the melody of thy vials, but let justice roll down as waters and righteousness as a mighty stream.
Amen.
Folks, we don't need a revival that's pleasing but not convicting.
Amen.
Come on now, right?
Amen.
Let me break it down for you. We don't need a revival that pleases us but doesn't please God.
Amen.
Come on now.
Amen.
We don't need sacrifices of ritual. We need sacrifices of righteousness. We don't need to gather in a holy place. We need to be gathered to a holy God. Come on, amen. We don't need to offer sacrifices. We need to offer ourselves. Come on now, you ready? We don't need melodies of praise. We don't need more melodies. I'm sick of that song. Really? When you get right with God, you'll love every song. We don't need more melodies of praise. We need harmony with God.
Yeah.
Folks, we don't need a revival that's pleasing but not convicting.
Yeah.
God's word says in Psalm 51, for the sacrifices of God are clear and a contrite heart.
Yeah.
You know, we need revivals that convict us.
Yeah.
Say, man, my life is messed up. Here I thought I had it all done again. I'm all that